Hello and welcome to the Symposium on Computer Animation 2020. In this session, we present the paper Efficient 2D Simulation on Moving 3D Surfaces. My name is Dieter Morgenroth. My co-authors were Stefan Reinhardt, Daniel Weisskopf, and Bernd Eberhardt. This work was done at the Visualization Research Center Stuttgart and the Media University Stuttgart. The initial inspiration for this work came from looking at an oil film on a water surface. We noticed that the interesting things happen on the surface only. To achieve such effects, it might be enough to simulate only the surface in high resolution. Our goal for this project was to create an accessible framework for 3D artists to create 2D simulations on moving 3D surfaces. I will first briefly talk about previous work before presenting the basic method and highlight our contribution. Finally, we will look at some results and I will summarize our findings. First, we researched existing methods for surface effects like splashes, bubbles, and foam. They can be categorized into two categories: two-way coupled effects and one-way coupled effects. For the two-way coupling, it is necessary to compute both the 3D volume and the surface effects in one simulation. The volume simulation affects the surface simulation, but the surface simulation can also affect the volume simulation. An example is real-time simulations of bubbles and foam within a shallow water framework from Thury et al. 2007. These methods can achieve the most realistic results. However, with these methods, whenever you tweak the surface effects, you need to re-simulate the whole volume simulation as well. In contrast, the one-way coupling methods can re-simulate only the surface effect simulation, because what happens in the surface simulation does not exert forces back onto the base simulation. Those methods can again be categorized into methods that compute surface effects in the 3D space, such as the paper Realistic Animation of Fluid with Splash and Foam, and methods that operate in 2D space, for example, surface turbulence for particle-based liquid simulations. This is the domain we are interested in. From the 2D methods, the closest point method from Root et al. Is best suited for our needs. For this method, you build a narrow band grid structure around your surface, as shown in this animation. Now, you transfer values from the 2D surface into the 3D space. At each grid cell, you store the surface value that you find at the closest surface point. This way, the grid values are the same when you move in space along the surface normal. The magic of this method is that almost all calculations executed in the 3D narrowband create the same results as if they were calculated in the surface's 2D space. Let's look at the method. It all starts with a coarse base animation of a surface volume. This could be a hand-animated object or a surface from a simulation. In this example, it is a fluid simulation using the SPH particle method. The first step is to convert the incoming geometry into a signed distance field. We then write the surface properties such as velocity, density, or color into narrowband 3D fields. We can render a colored surface by transferring the computed color values back to the vertices of the mesh of the input surface. With the next three steps, surface evolution, couple dynamics, and solve PDEs, we simulate fine scale details to enhance the coarse input. We bring quantities from the 3D simulation into our surface domain in a coupling step, and then use the closest point method to solve in a 3D narrowband grid around the surface. Here you can see the comparison of the coarse input to the fine details created with the surface simulation. Let's look at the key steps of our method: surface evolution, coupling, and surface dynamics. The surface evolution describes how we treat our quantities when the surface moves through the 3D space as shown in the animation. We have the surface M. The velocity field U defines how the surface evolves to the next time step. We map the point P along the normal direction to its counterpart P prime. We can now attach quantities to the point. These quantities can be either scalar-valued quantities or vector-valued quantities. The scalar-valued quantities can either be extensive, which means that they are global properties like mass, or intensive properties like density, which we need to adapt based on the change in surface area. This can be computed using the divergence of the velocity u projected onto the tangent space TPM at point P. For this adaptation, we derived the equation that defines how the scalar value A has to be changed based on the divergence of the velocity field u projected to the surface into the tangent space TPM. An example of this adaptation of the density is a growing sphere. Here we expect that the density decreases when the sphere grows. In the comparison, you see that with our correction, the density changes when the sphere radius changes. This change can also be verified against the analytical solution, which we did in the paper. In addition to scalar quantities, we can also attach vector quantities, as for example the inner velocity to a point. Those vectors live in the tangential space of the surface TPM. This space is then connected to the target space TP prime M prime. When the surface M evolves, we can define a point P on the surface. At this point, the surface has the surface normal N. We can associate the velocity V with the point P. If we move the velocity along and project it back to the surface, then the length of the velocity vector changes. Instead of projecting, we need to rotate the vector, so the length is preserved. In the equation, the first part brings the vector into the target space, the second part preserves the length. To demonstrate the effect of our vector length conservation, we performed an experiment with a rotating surface, where we initialized the inner velocity field with a tangential velocity, and then rotated the surface 90 degrees. We simulated the surface with and without the length correction and a static surface as a reference side by side. Without the length correction, the surface simulation shows much lower speeds of the imposed simulation and even stops in the middle of the surface. In the corrected version, the velocity is preserved during the rotation and matches the static surface. Next, I will describe the coupling step. Without coupling, the movement of the 3D surface influences the inner velocity of our surface simulation only in the normal direction un. We couple the tangential part with our friction model. This model uses the relative velocity v rel, which is the difference between the tangential part of the outer velocity and the inner velocity, and a scalar factor S1 that is exposed as a user parameter. We can add a second term that adapts for the change of surface. In the coupling step, we also added a user parameter to add some noise to the coupling strength. Here you can see an example for using the noise parameter to create fine details when coupling the surface simulation to the underlying rotating sphere. For coupling scalar quantities, we use sources and sinks. We also provide a user parameter that drives how fast the relative differences of the external and internal values are compensated. With this approach, we can, for example, add sources for high temperature in a thermal convection simulation as shown in this example. Now that we have modeled the influence of the outer process to the surface quantities, we can describe the process that should happen on the surface. For this, we can use a set of partial differential equations, PDEs, that are solved in our narrowband. Here we can tackle all kinds of problems that can be described as PDEs. Although they are solved in a 3D grid, thanks to the closest point method, they produce the same result as if they were solved in the tangential space. For testing, we implemented different types of PDEs. We implemented Navier-Stokes equations, thermal equations, and reaction diffusion equations. We also tested our method with a scene that is closer to production scenes when it comes to simulation resolution and polygon count. This river flow animation was simulated with the Houdini flip solver and then post-processed with our surface simulation step. We predict that this two-step approach will work well in production scenarios where multiple artists are working on one scene. We measure the performance using Houdini's built-in performance monitor that allows the export of results to a text file. This way we were able to get exact timings of the runtime of each Houdini node. Our main takeaway of this exercise was that our nodes operate in the same magnitude of time as all the other Houdini operators. The main advantage of the method is that the computation can be limited to a narrow band around the surface. For our mass conservation example with the growing sphere, it is possible to calculate the correct solution with a closed form equation. This analytical solution can then be compared with the simulated result. We measured the mean absolute error. We repeated this measurement with different grid resolutions to inspect how the solution converges to the correct solution. Although we can see a trend with higher resolution, we were not able to clearly identify the order of convergence. Several effects seem to overlap, so this field needs further investigation in the future. We presented a method to solve PDEs on evolving surfaces. We derived physically motivated conservation laws and coupling strategies. We coupled simulations of 3D and 2D space in a way that allows us to compute high-resolution 2D simulations on coarse input surfaces efficiently. We demonstrated that our approach could be used for different types of problems that require solving PDEs on a moving surface. We implemented all needed modules in the Houdini software package as reusable operators. Outlook for future work could be to implement boundary conditions that allow calculation of obstacles and different kinds of PDEs to compute droplet formations that then could be used for animated wet maps. If you want to try out the project for yourself, the source code is available on github.com/demo3d-cappuccino. We want to thank Marius Wysirski for his help in setting up the river simulation and his support in all Houdini questions. This work is partly supported by Kooperatives Promotionskolleg Digital Media at Stuttgart Media University and the University of Stuttgart.